to the stats that have just come through, apparently 20% of the tourism sites here in Uganda are unknown, not because people don't know about them, but because people have never tried to even just move outside their perimeter within their homesteads to find out amazing places. This episode of Ecozone, we are looking at the conservation bit of the show this time around. Did you know that there's a place called a floating island where you could have a very good time, very chill place? This is the place I'm talking about in the background. And of course, on the extreme side, that is Lake Victoria. We are actually in the homesteads of some people. So we're going to find out what does this place have to offer in terms of tourism. And in case you're out there and you're staying in Luzira and you want to have a good time, which place can you go to? And of course, what activities should you be looking forward to here at the floating island? In case you're just joining us right about now, we are at the official floating island, and I'm going to be giving you details, because before you get to find out about a place, you need some information as far as history is concerned. Now, next to me, I have the man behind all those ideas, the man whose idea came to life after he actually had this artificial floating island come into existence. He goes by the names of James Kateba. What's up? How are you doing, man?
I'm doing okay. How are you doing?
Very fantastic. Are you a Rastafarian?
I'm not a Rastafarian. I'm an African. Yeah.
What's with the small dreams?
That's how I feel like being, really. Nothing so much, really. Okay. Yeah.
Interesting. Now, one tip before we get into deep conversation. If you're a Rastafarian out there, if you're a guy who likes to chill, if you're a guy who likes to enjoy your easy Sundays, easy weekends, this is the place to be. I'll be letting you know why. Now, James, I want us to first and foremost get back in history, way back. How did you come up with this island? How did this place come into existence?
Basically, I've been in the tourism industry for quite a long time. This idea came sometime back in about 2 years ago. I looked at uses of how we had to recycle mineral water bottles. We are basically sitting on about 9 tons of plastic bottles recycled, and they give us the buoyancy. So I decided to make up something on Lake Victoria as a way of trying to clean up the environment, you know, basically picking away the bottles, recycling them, making them into something like a boat.
So 9 tons of plastic bottles, that is a lot of bottles. How long did it take you to come up with all these bottles?
It took us about 6 months to get the bottles together. We strapped them on rafts, added tons and tons of soil, and then we had to recreate, you know, as you can see, we had to recreate what you'd find on the sides of Lake Victoria. So basically, we pick up plants that are endemic to the area, get them together, and then we try to recreate like another wetland. Right. Yeah, another wetland. Mm. The difference between this wetland and another wetland is that we can move this wetland, we can move it away from here into places that are so polluted.
Wait, so can you move this one to the waters? Do not go away, because we are going to be moving on the waters of Lake Victoria here in Luzira. Now, still looking at the history of this place, when did you have this idea of, you know, having a floating island?
The idea came about in 2017. We thought we had a beautiful lake in Uganda, but there wasn't much that we were gaining out of the lake in terms of tourism. So I thought of something out of the box, because There was a community. I read about a community on Lake Kyoga in the 50s. These communities live on rafts out of bamboo and papyrus.
So, and in Thailand, we have people who are living on, you know, those kind of environments.
Yeah, but we had something here in Uganda, in Africa. So that's the idea that I had to bring up in a different situation.
Now, how hard has it been for you as far as, you know, keeping this place alive is? Is it something that comes off with an ease after you've, you know, set out everything, you're good to go, or?
Well, basically, there's nothing easy in when you're trying to do something. There's nothing easy. We've been having issues with the weather, climate, with rains. You know, you have times where this island gets blown away. We just have to pick it up.
What do you mean blown away? Does it, you know, get shredded into pieces or?
No, not really. You know,
you find it when you have, you know, left it here, and you find it when it has moved to the other shore.
There are times when we have storms on Lake Victoria, and if you don't tether it properly, there are times you find it like moved, like some miles away from here. You know, but it is safe. It doesn't sink. It stays.
Yeah, we're going to find out a little bit later on in terms of how safe this place can be. Now, we are in Luzira. That one we very understand. But how many acres of land are you seated on right about now? And in case someone is watching us and probably they're in Kawempe, they're in Gulu even, you know, they're in Soroti, they're in Imbarara, and they would like to come and have a good time at that fish or, you know, floating island. How do you direct someone? Where are you located?
We are located just a couple of, about 2 kilometers from the Port Bell Pier. We are at a point where an inland port is going to be built right across where we're seated. It's about basically 2 kilometers from Luzira, on Peninsula Crescent in Luzira, Port Bell. Yeah.
Very interesting. Now, I want you to paint me a picture of how this place was like, because we're now looking at the history. We have started off this ecozone conservation story at Fisher Floating Island with history. How was this place like before, you know, you put up all this wood, before you came up with the tons of plastic bottles?
Basically, this was a swamp. We had tons and tons of migratory birds. They still come. They are seasonal. So the time we started building this thing up, we were wading through the swamp all the way from the road. So it was basically a swamp. We just created the bridge that you saw as you coming in. And that's how we started this place here.
And how was it during the starting points? Because I'm seeing some, communities around. I'm seeing some people who live in this neighborhood. How was it during those first days when you actually got this idea and it was time to put it into practice?
Basically, they were just fishermen. Fishermen, you know, illegal fishermen.
Are they still illegal?
They probably weren't using the right methods to do their fishing. Yeah, but once we started it up, I think it got accessible to so many people. Mm-hmm. Basically, that's how it was. Yeah.
When we talk about, you know, the people receiving it, how was it like those first days when it was open? Did you have people criticizing you and saying, how safe is this place? Is this place even safe? We want to get into those first details, because understanding the fact that you have been in existence for a couple of years, we want to know how have you come from way back up to this time around.
Well, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy. But, you know, the encouragement was there. People would, they were like, you know, we don't think this thing is going to be safe. And I would run them through what I thought, you know, would work. And eventually, they took it on. You know, they came on board. Yeah.
Were you among the people that were hands-on in terms of, you know, piling up these plastic bottles with sand and making sure that this thing is actually firm?
Yes, that's true. I was one of the people that was setting it up. I'm basically guiding, directing it. Okay. Yeah.
And how many youth did you have employed here to do that?
We had about five young boys and a couple of ladies that used to pick up these bottles, selling them to us. And then we did the strapping, and everything was done here on the mainland. And then we'd just flip them over and just join them together. Yeah.
How has the experience been so far, you know, looking at where you started from and what you've achieved so far? What has been your biggest achievement with this artificial floating island?
The achievement was to be able to get something, you know, that something that has never been thought of, basically thinking out of the box. But, you know, that just made my day at the time. And, you know, the fact that we can come here, you know, we create some space on water that we can drive away. And then we have, you know, birds in the mornings. Birds, we have monitor lizards that sometimes use this as their habitat. And then the numbers of catfish increasing in the area. Yeah, we have tons and tons of catfish swimming around sometimes in the day. Yeah.
Earlier on, you told us about, you know, some fishermen who are here doing some illegal fishing. Now that you have tons of fish that are, you know, is coming through to the waters, what have you done as far as, you know, illegal fishing this time around is concerned to make sure that at the end of the day, you know, they have something to eat, they have something to sell, and they can at the end of the day, you know, sustain their lives?
Yeah, basically the government came up with guidelines on the right way to do fishing. But, you know, further to that, you know, we buy fish from them, standard, you know, good sized fish, not the little immature fish. Yeah, that's how we support them as communities. We also have some canoes that we give out to the communities, just in case they need to transit across. You know, we give them, yeah, complimentary.
Canoes are like a complementary.
Complimentary transport, boat transport. We have a couple of boats that they can use at no charge. Yeah.
So what we're going to do at this point in time, we're going to go in for a very short break. We're still trying to understand the history of the artificial floating island. It is here in Kampala and, of course, in Luzira. You could be in Luzira and you've never heard of this place. It is just next to UBL. You slope down Port Bell like this. You'll be at the right place. I'll be giving you details later on with, of course, James, the man behind the idea of having this island come into existence. Keep it right here with me on Ecozone Conservation. I don't know what you're doing for this Saturday evening, but I definitely believe that now that you're still watching Acres and Conservation and, of course, enjoying our conversation as far as, you know, the artificial floating island is concerned, located in Luzira, I'm going to be giving you more details about this island. And, of course, later on, it could be within this episode or the next episode, we shall be going to the waters itself. I mean, this island is going to be set free. So if you want to experience that interesting bit of the show, all you need to do is keep it right here with me on Ecozone every Saturday at, of course, 7 p.m. on Urban Television. Now, we're still with James, and of course, before we went in for a break, we've talked about a couple of things, the history, how you've evolved this place. Now, I want us to talk about the conservation bit here, because this is the main important thing that I want us to cover on the show. When you look at this place, it has been conserved in a very artificial or naturalistic way, using, you know, just plain woods and the things that actually we grow our very own. How have you managed to achieve that? How have you conserved this island?
Basically, what we do, we try to have as much vegetation on the island. The idea is to have the root network weave through every single bottle of the foundation of the base, get held together, bound by roots, and then we just keep topping it up with normal sand and soil. Eventually it will grow as wild as any normal setting, any normal wetland. So we don't have much to do other than just having to have the greenery on the island. Yeah.
And how about the green, the grass itself? How do you conserve it? How do you make sure it is well kept, it is cut, it is green, it is just as natural as possible?
We just do some trimming just for us to be able to, you know, to live in comfort. But the other parts that you don't see are the roots. The roots keep growing. Much as you do the thinning at the top, the roots keep going through the entire vessel. Actually, if you looked at the other side of the island, you can see that we already have some sections of forests coming up. Forests papyrus wetlands, you know, taking over sections of the island. Yeah.
Okay, now, how about the timber itself? I want to first understand, where did you get this timber from and what type of timber did you use?
Timber is sourced locally. It's supposed to be something to hold the frame as the root, as the as the base takes shape, it will go away. It will have at one point we'll have only sand and just vegetation and no more soil. The wood that we have here is basically something that to provide us with some comfort as we're moving around. Yeah.
We have been experiencing a rainy season, of course, here in Kampala, and we understand once it's a rainy season, water levels tend to be high, especially on Lake Victoria. Have you had instances where water, floods off to this side of the island?
We do not have a problem with water, bothering us in terms of rising levels, because we rise up with the water levels and we go down with the water levels. Yeah, meaning we are floating on the surface of the lake. Yeah.
Now, I want to take you a little bit back to when, you were putting these water bottles down. How deep did you go? And, if we're looking at the height, do you remember those measurements?
We're about 2 meters above, the depth is about 2 meters. So we are basically floating on 2 meters. Yeah, 2 meters.
When you were having this idea, did you actually think this was something that was going to be, appreciated by the community? Or did you even do it just for you as a person, as James, to just come here and chill with friends and have a good time?
It was something that I knew, they would love, because I've been in the travel industry, in the tourism industry for quite a while. And I realized we don't do much for our local folk. So I knew at one point they're going to come and they'll get wowed by the experience here.
One thing I've noticed with this place, you are the water, you are Lake Victoria, and you do have some water height and nevertheless, but you're on the lake. How do you conserve this lake? How do you keep it clean?
Well, this is at the extreme end of the Murchison Bay channel, the bay. It's something that happens naturally. The water hyacinth is seasonal. There are times when we have it lots, in quantities, but along the way, like in the evening, it gets blown away to other areas of the lake. There was a time when we had other islands getting blown over here, moving into our area, but we don't have any control over things like that. Yeah.
Do you have specific ways of, maintaining the water hyacinth, or even do you actually have people who go in there and maybe say approach it or something?
I think the government has done much about that. Just that you just find little pieces that are creeping over here, but we don't have, we don't have much. I think that's
talking about the government, when you talk about government and we're on a tourism show, you do not forget the board, that is the UTB, right? And understanding your background, you have been someone that has been part of tourism as far as this country is concerned. Is it something you have tabled to UTB, for them to come and check out your island? Have you even gotten any support from these guys?
UTB will come in. UTB will come in. We just wanted to make sure something starts. We informed the authorities of the environment, NEMA, we talked to them and we told them we're setting up something here. We just wanted to make sure something is being done right. Yeah, along the way we'll get them to come on board and see how things get moving. Yeah.
What was the response from NEMA when you told them about this place, and understanding that NEMA is also very responsible for our environment, and I see you have used a lot of wood here. I don't know, what was their response like?
Basically this thing was being done for the first time, I think, in the country. I talked to the officials at NEMA, a couple of officers, and I told them I was trying to duplicate what is being lost out there in terms of wetland degradation. They were like, yeah, try, as long as you know what you're doing, as long as it's not harming the environment. And then they referred me to the Minister of Water as well. We had a chat, wrote to them, and this is what is happening now. They always come check on us and see how things are.
We have friends who come from UT, from NEMA and from Water.
And the ministry, yeah. they always want to see that we're doing something right, yeah.
Just remind me, how many acres are we seated on right about now, this particular island?
We are on 250 square meters of water so far. This is what I could afford with my limited resources.
Do you have any plans of expanding it and maybe having upstretch a little bit further to about more 200 square miles?
We can only think about the beginning, yeah. But we're still in consultation with them, you know, on what is best for the environment, and basically this is just like an art piece. We wanted to first try out something, see how it works, maybe.
How long are you planning on this tryout? Because you've been in existence for a couple of years. People have come to this place, they've embraced the beauty. I've had someone tell me about it, and I'm like, as Ecozone, we need to go down and check on it. How long is this tryout going to be happening?
It will go on. You know, once you have bottles in that kind of setting, you're basically looking at about 450 years.
450 years?
Yeah.
So wait, so who's going to be in charge of this after you're gone?
the little ones coming after us. It's okay.
Were they the small water bottles or the big ones? Yeah. Which ones did you use in particular?
Several types, sizes of mini water bottles, really, yeah. All with airtight, with their lids on. Yeah, all kinds of bottles, really, yeah.
So at any particular point, water will not be a problem to us when it gets to the famity of those bottles down there?
No. As long as you have the roots going through, as long as you have vegetation on the piece.
Would these roots be actually the cause of our problems? Because I'm thinking about, you know, the fact that you mentioned the forest that is just a few, you know, miles away from where we are seated right about now. You have the water hyacinth that is here. You have the green vegetation that you do have here. Don't you think at some particular point those will be too many roots that would actually affect the famity of this place?
No, the roots actually add up to the famity of the place. They also help biofilter. Like whenever we have runoff water from towns, garages and all that, they pick up all the contamination. They biofilter, they hold everything together. Yeah, that's what we think we are doing.
What is the one thing that you hold so dear about this island?
Ooh, I wouldn't know. Just being here and just breathing in, you know, fresh air and sitting with a couple of friends, chatting about, you know, just basically de-stressing.
Do you always have the sunset or the sunrise? Do you experience those?
Yeah, we do experience sunrises and sunsets. We also have very beautiful, a beautiful moon glow. Sometimes of the month, you know, we have good moments here.
Which ones are your best seasons or best days for someone to actually come and, you know, check out this artificial floating island?
We are busier over the weekends. People come, you know, sit around here, just taking the breeze. But every day is a good day to come and just relax, really, yeah.
Quite interesting. Now, in case you're out there and you're wondering, why aren't we moving, of course, to the lake? That means that we, unfortunately, running out of time. Now, what I'm going to promise you is very simple. You have had the history of this place. You have had how this man conserves this place. And definitely, it is one of those places that you need to visit, especially if you've been crying about, you know, saying tourism sites are very far. You know, you do not have that lots of money to enjoy life. You can definitely come here, that fish floating island, and check out what tourism has to offer, what beauty has to offer in terms of course embracing what Lake Victoria is like and this particular island. All you need to do is make your way to Luzira on the next episode of the show. That's going to be next Saturday. I'm going to be on the waters of Lake Victoria. I'm going to let this island flow with me, and I'm going to be finding out what activities actually happen on this island, and you who is there when you do come here, what is the first thing that you should actually ask for. All that and much more will be coming in next week. All you need to do is keep it right here on Ecozone and enjoy your Saturday evening. My name is Derek Ainedasha. I'll see you probably on YouTube. In case you missed out this, just head over there and look for Ecozone. You'll have all the shows that you have missed out.